So thank you very much.
Technical and your own personal experiences, probably that's the audience was looking for. Thank you very much. For our next talk, to address us, I request Dr. Pradeep Dua to be on dais.
Dr. CB said that he has nothing left to say, but still he could say so much. Now I am nervous. I don't have really anything to say. He had some practical experiences to share. I don't have that too even. So anyway, so this is the old presentation I've already said. This is the previous presentation. It would be too boring to repeat it. So this is just a humble attempt to, you know, focus on the theme of the conference and a quick run through the literature and then a brief gist review of the scientific studies that have been done regarding the rasayana drugs. So India is a country which is blessed with, you know, a lot of treasures, and medicinal plants is one of the best treasures that we have. We have an armamentarium of more than 5,600 medicinal plants. Ayurveda says that everything is having some medicinal value, but these are the plants about which we know that they have a medicinal value. Health, as per Ayurveda, is defined as sam doshaha samagni cha samadhatu malkriyaha prasannatmendriya mana swastitya vidhyate. Means it is a state of, you know, perfect balance between the doshas, between the agni, between the dhatus and the malas. And you know, in the morning also somebody said that this definition of health is in perfect coherence with the definition of health given by WHO, which states that health is a state of physical, mental, social, and earlier it was mentioned spiritual also, but that is not included in the official definition now. So health is a state of physical, mental, social, and spiritual well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. What is the objective of Ayurveda? Why do we all study Ayurveda? Well, we study Ayurveda not to add life to our, not to add years to our life, but to add life to our years, whatever years are left. You know, the two basic objectives of Ayurveda are swasthasya swasthya rakshana, aturasya vikara prashmanancha, means to maintain the health of the healthy and to treat the ailing mankind. Perhaps to the best of my knowledge, Ayurveda is the first system of medicine, you know, or the first, you know, treatise on life sciences, which lays emphasis, equal emphasis on preventive healthcare. In the modern system of medicine, preventive healthcare is a very recent concept, whereas in Ayurveda, you can see out of the two objectives, prevention is one of the foremost objectives. Rather, out of these two, prevention has been mentioned as first. Aging in Ayurveda, first of all, let us understand what is aging. Aging is in fact the natural tendency of life. Everybody has to age. Whosoever is born has to age and die. So Ayurveda describes in detail the pattern of sequential aging. In the morning also, I think Professor Gangadharji discussed about the sequential loss of different aspects of our life and strength. So Ayurveda describes in details the pattern of sequential losses of biological strength with advancing age in relation to the doctrine of Tridosha. Rasayana or rejuvenation therapy, if we can correlate it with this term, is the strength of Ayurveda in terms of geriatric care, and Rasayana compensates this age-related biological sequential loss, and to a great extent you cannot avoid, but you can definitely slow down, you can delay the untimely jara, the untimely aging. Holistic combination of Rasayana with Ayurvedic dietetics, positive lifestyle, which includes dinacharya, prithucharya, yoga, and spirituality, offers the complete and effective package of rasayana. Rasayana, for that matter, doesn't mean only taking some ashwagandha or some punanava or some drugs. Rasayana is, in fact, again, a holistic thing. We have heard a lot about holism. So rasayana is a holistic approach. It is not merely a drug or not merely one exercise that can, you know, that can have that rejuvenating effect. Vagbhata and Sharangdhara have described the process of aging, depicting the features of specific bio losses occurring during the decades of life. It has been mentioned that Balyam Vriddhi Chavi Medha Twak Drishti Shukra Vikramo Buddhi Karmendriyam Iti Jivitam Dashmo Haseth. Means, if the life span of a human being is of 100 years, so 10 decades have been described, and each decade there is a sequential loss of different body vitalities. And then, like, there is gradual loss of childhood, gradual loss of growth, luster, intellect, etc. as you grow. So most of us are in the category of, you know, 31 to 40 and 41 to 50, so we need to assess whether we are really losing intellect or not. So for each decade, to compensate for each bio loss, you know, Shastras have advocated the use of specific rasayana drugs, like it's mentioned in the slide. You can have it later. Rasayanas have been classified in the Shastras on the basis of, you know, many virtues. Like, for example, Dravyabhut Rasayana and Adravyabhut Rasayana. Dravyabhut means when we give some intervention in form of a medicine or whatever, and Adravyabhut when there is no intervention in the form of any Dravya or any material. Then as per the method, again, Rasayana is classified as Kuti Praveshik, Vatatvik and Droni Praveshik. So no doubt we are mostly using this Vatatvik Rasayana Vidhi these days. There are very few centers or very few places which are using the other two modalities. So Vatatvik means the patient walks in the OPD, the physician assesses and prescribes the medicines and Rasayana drugs, do's and don'ts, and the patient follows it when he goes to home and then again comes back to you. Whereas Koti Praveshik and Droni Praveshik are sort of, you know, indoor modalities of Rasayana administration. As per the scope of use, rasayanas are again divided into Kamya Rasayana, Namittik Rasayana and Ajasrik Rasayana. So from rasayanas can be prescribed to a already healthy person from the point of view or from the, you know, objective of attaining further health. Rasayanas can be prescribed for a particular disease, or rasayanas can be prescribed in the form of milk and milk related recipes. As per the contents of the rasayana, again it can be ahar rasayana, it can be aushad rasayana, and it can be achar rasayana. Achar, I would like to specify for those who are not from Ayurveda, achar doesn't mean pickle here. So achar means our behavior, our, you know, outlook towards life, how do we lead our life, how do we interact with the people, how do we interact with ourselves. There are specific categories of rasayana also, like Medhya Rasayana, mainly meant to target the intellect related virtues. Then, you know, disease specific rasayana, as I've already mentioned. Then there is Prabhav related classification of rasayanas, where it can be Sanshodhan Rasayana, Sanshaman Rasayana, and all that. So there are different classifications, but the ultimate objective is one, to rejuvenate the body. Rasayan Tantra is one of the eight specialities of Ayurveda, Ashtanga Ayurveda, which deals with the therapeutic nutrition and immuno-enhancing interventions for longevity. The rasayana interventions are essentially molecular nutrients actually, and nutrition absorption and assimilation enhancing agents through rasa, through agni and through srotas. You know, simple administration of a nourishing food, or for that matter any rejuvenating therapy, doesn't have any good effect if it is not properly absorbed, if it is not properly digested, if it is not properly assimilated. Like Dr. CB gave an example, that poor lady perhaps passed away because, you know, her digestive fire was still in the phase of recovery, and giving non-vegetarian food perhaps by virtue that is a bit harder to digest, and she and her digestive fire couldn't cope up with that. So even if you are giving a nourishing food, but that is not being digested, absorbed and assimilated, it cannot have any rasayana effect or regenerative effect on your body. This is the, you know, how the rasayana acts on your body. The prerequisite is Sanshodhana. Of course, there is an example given in Ayurveda that you cannot dye a cloth which is you cannot give a good color to a cloth which is not properly washed. So you need to do Shuddhikaran of the body, you need to do cleansing of your body before the rasayana drugs can act. So this is, you know, a WHO report which says that during the last few decades there has been a noticeable rise in the average life expectancy. In the morning also we heard from the speakers that over a period of time, you know, it's a positive sign that the life expectancy in the human beings across the globe has been increasing, especially in the developed and the developing countries. But with this, we are getting a new cluster of, you know, age-specific diseases which affect the aging population. So again, Rasayana has a revived interest of the population. The areas of special consideration in Ayurveda, they include geriatrics, rejuvenation, nutrition, immunology, genetics, and higher consciousness. And probably a combination of these may be addressed as a holistic approach to Rasayana. Geriatric care has two distinct dimensions. So what do we need to take care of when we deal with the senior citizen? One, promotion of health and longevity, as everybody wants. And second is the treatment of specific diseases which the people of this age group are prone to suffer or are suffering. So the conventional modern medicine is apparently strong in terms of the second dimension, means management of the diseases. Again, I'm using the word apparently. Whereas Ayurveda is notably strong in terms of the first dimension, that is to prevent aging and to promote healthy living and longevity. The foremost classic of Ayurveda, that is Charak Samhita, begins its deliberations in the very first chapter with the Dirgha Jivati Adhyaya. Ayurveda describes a regimen of rejuvenative measures called rasayanas, claimed to be micronutrients which are meant to impart biological sustenance to the body tissues. Some of these rasayanas are organ and tissue specific, like Medhya rasayanas, specially meant to improve the intellect, like for example Ashwagandha, Brahmi, Mandukuparni, Shankhapushpi, all well-known drugs. There is a reference to, you know, what we call as immunity. Immunity today is considered, you know, in terms of vaccination, in terms of anti-sera and antigens that we inject. But immunity is something more than this. In Ayurveda, the bala is the term which we can, you know, equate with immunity in the modern concept. It is of three types, that is Sahaj Bal, which is constitutional by virtue of your birth. When you are born with this Sahaj Bal in your body. Kalaj Bal, which appears in your body over a period of time because of different reasons. And Yuktikrit, that you acquire by virtue of healthy nutrition, by virtue of healthy lifestyle and other factors. So Sahaj Bal is an inherent characteristic property of an organism, individual, which is present since birth because of equilibrium in the state of doshas. Kalaj Bal is dependent on the season and age. You know, there are people who are otherwise healthy, but during the change of season, they develop certain problems. Loss of strength is observed in Adhan Kal. Gaining of strength is observed in case of Visarga Kal, and middle age is considered as full of strength. Yuktikrit Bal means acquired strength. It is dependent on healthy practices related to diet, yoga, rasayana, vajikarana, therapy, etc. and to acquire strength by fulfilling the necessary deficiencies in the deficient dhatus. There is a concept, there is a term again and again used in Ayurveda, and when we try to correlate it with modern science, we use the term adaptogen. You know, the term adaptogen was coined by a Russian scientist. Actually, I didn't know much about this term, what was the etymology, so I learned it very recently, wanted to share it with you. So a Russian scientist, Lazarev, in 1947, while working on a synthetic compound, Dibazole, which was found to stimulate the non-specific resistance of organisms, he coined this term adaptogen. And nearly 20 years later, another scientist, he defined adaptogen more precisely and put forth certain specific criteria to qualify to be labeled as an adaptogen. So an adaptogen must produce a non-specific response, that is increase in the power of resistance against multiple stressors. It should have the quality of normalizing influence irrespective of the direction of change from physiological norms caused by the stressor, and it should be innocuous and not influence normal body functions more than required. You know, here is the catch. Here we see that bal and immunity, adaptogen, these are slightly different. The immunity from the modern concept, from the present day concept of point of view, doesn't qualify for these characteristics of an adaptogen, whereas the rasayana concept purely qualifies with this definition of an adaptogen. And several plants these days have been researched, evidence-based papers have been produced to show their adaptogenic properties, and most of them, most important of them include well-known plants like Tenophora cordifolia, Asparagus racemosus, Embolica officinalis, Withania somnifera, Piper longum, and Terminalia cebula. Several institutions across the country, in India I would say, and certain global institutes also, so they are working on, you know, generating evidence. This is the age of evidence, so without evidence nobody agrees whether this is true or not. So Rasayana is one of the hot topics and people are working across the globe on this, and I could call out some conclusions or gist of several papers that I went through. Various types of plant-based Rasayana recipes, single plants as well as formulations, are mentioned in Ayurveda. PubMed search for Rasayana drugs has indicated that several single plants have been researched, of which Asparagus racemosus, that is Shatavari, and Withania somnifera, that is Ashwagandha, were the most studied Rasayana plants. Brahmarasayana is the most studied Rasayana formulation. It was observed that free radical scavenging activity was the most studied activity of the Rasayana plants and formulations, followed by the immunomodulatory activity. Regarding the free radical scavenging activity, what I could find was that free radicals, you know, we all know that free radicals are the charged particles that are produced as byproducts, and they are capable of attacking the cells and damaging the body tissues. Withania somnifera, Phyllanthus emblica have been studied for their free radical scavenging activity, and in one of the most of the papers, you know, they point to a property in cold stress induced rodent models. I could find a lot of studies. Enzymes such as superoxide dismutase, glutathione peroxidase, glutathione reductase, and catalase have been used to assess the antioxidant potential of these plants. Doxorubicin induced DNA damage protective activity of Cynodon dactylon, I think that is Murva, has also been reported by several studies in vitro studies. The significance of the Rasayana as immunomodulating agents compared to other conventional immunomodulators is that they activate the immune function without altering the other basic parameters of the body. So this is not seen in case of, you know, modern immunoboosters when we talk about. Humoral immunity in terms of antibody production and cell-mediated immunity in terms of delayed type of hypersensitivity have been stimulated by various Rasayana herbs and formulations. N-acyclospyrethrum, asparagus, chlorophytum are some of the Rasayana herbs, while Brahmarasayana and Ashwagandha Rasayana are the formulations studied in the stimulatory property of the acquired immune system. Rasayanas have also the potential to be used as vaccine adjuvants. There are several studies on this where Rasayana drugs have been used as an adjuvant to the vaccination that we give to the children these days. Like, most important of them is Asparagus racemosus, Shatavari, and Withania somnifera. They have found to increase the protective immune response by improving the serological and hematological parameters following the DPT vaccination. Diseases such as Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, Huntington's, they occur as a result of neurodegenerative processes. We all know that Medhya Rasayanas like Shankapushpi, like Ashwagandha, Brahmi and Mandukuparni are well-studied drugs, and they have been found to retard the brain aging and help in regeneration of neural tissues, besides producing anti-stress, adaptogenic and memory-enhancing effects. Withania has been studied as a mood stabilizer also, and for management of epilepsy, stress, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, tardive dyskinesia, cerebral ischemia, and drug addiction. Asparagus has also been shown to have anti-amnesia activity. It inhibited the acetylcholinesterase enzyme in specific brain regions and in a dose-dependent manner. And Brahmarasayana, described for improving memory and immunity, has been found to act as a memory restorative agent also. Rasayana drugs are these days being studied for their radioprotective effect also. You know, the patients of cancer, whatsoever is the expected outcome, still nobody can resist undergoing this chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So once they undergo radiotherapy, they are bound to have certain side effects, certain, you know, unavoidable side effects, adverse effects of the radiotherapy. And Rasayana drugs have been found to provide some relief, some protection to such patients. Radiotherapy has almost become a necessary evil, I've discussed, and ionizing radiation affects almost every part of the body, especially those parts of the body where the cell multiplication rate is very high. So especially it includes the skin, the gastrointestinal epithelium and the hematopoietic system, and most of the patients undergoing radiotherapy show some side effects, some damages, some complexities in terms of these body systems. So antioxidant enzymes like superoxide dismutase, catalase and glutathione peroxidase act as the first line of defense against these free radicals. Brahma Rasayana has been studied and it has shown significant reduction in the exposure induced cases in the liver, in the enzymes of liver, and like lipid peroxidase, and increase in the superoxide dismutase, catalase and GSH levels. Even Triphala has also been shown to increase the radiation tolerance, thereby extending the protection to both gastrointestinal cells and the cells of the hematopoietic system. Apart from these two, a lot of studies have been done on Tenospora cordifolia, that is Guduchi, also for its radioprotective effect. That is all I have to share, and the only thing that I would like to share is that in the morning also I said, you know, there is a lot of potential in our own Indian systems of medicine, but yes, the time says it is the need of the hour that we join hands with our counterparts in the other systems of medicine. Let us all work together, let us shed our egos, let us try to find scientific evidence in whatever we give to our patients. No system is complete, but every system has some strength. We need to borrow the strengths for the benefit of our patients. Thank you so much.